Welcome to today's video. Today's video, I am joined by George, who works for EcoPlug. He's their lead tech director.
Yeah, technical director.
EcoPlug. Yeah, so he's the guy who's in charge of pressing all the jobs for EcoPlug, and today he's come out to explain what you need to do if you're wanting a workplace OLEV grant. So George, what's the first thing that you need when you're fitting a workplace charger? I presume you need to do a survey of your sites to make sure you're suitable. What makes you suitable?
So yeah, before that, you need to know if you're going to have, if you've got a company car or your staff have got cars. So once you know that information, if you've got staff with like a Zoe or an i3, anything like that, you'll be able to get the workplace grant. So for workplace chargers, the actual customer needs to do that first. So you need to go online like you've done yourself.
Yeah.
Get the actual workplace voucher. Once you've got that information, it's down to finding an installer. Once you've found an installer, like EcoPlug, we can do workplace chargers. You then get in touch with them and then go for all the survey, like obviously we have done to get to this step now.
So for EcoPlug to do a survey and give you I mean, your prices for workplace chargers, how accurate are they? Are they within the straight away or?
Yeah, so once we've got the pictures, so obviously I get like Nick to take a picture of his main fuse, of the consumer unit and where he wants the charge point location to be. And a description of the run, this is going in the ceiling and this job here. Once I've got that, I'll generate a price, get you a nice fixed price, and what the price is on that quote is what you pay. If we need to do extra work, we cover that cost for you, and everything's just covered in that one quotation. So.
Okay, so the quotation that you give is the price that we'll
yeah,
pay?
Yeah, that's the price you'll pay for.
Okay,
that.
So for example, when I did this one here, what I did was, I not only took a picture of here, and I also did a little video for you.
Yeah, video is perfect.
Yeah.
It saves coming out for a site survey. If there's a lot of chargers and we feel that there needs to be a site survey, then we will come out over free of charge. But this one, fairly simple install, and a nice video just does it for you.
I mean, the advantage I've got here is this: we've got fake roofs in here. It's a nice straight run. There's basically nothing really too complex. For me, you're doing a 22 kilowatt install,
yep.
But for workplaces, can it be single phase?
Yeah, it can be single phase. You can do 3.6, we don't generally fit 3.6. If you're gonna do it right, get a 7 kilowatt or a 22 kilowatt like yourself. Faster charging, and it incorporates bigger batteries. When you've got the bigger battery cars, they can charge it faster.
So price point workplace charger, what's the difference between the actual cost of installing a 3.6 or a 22 kilowatt charger?
So there's not that much difference. It is mainly just the cable run costs, and if you've got a longer run, then that's gonna cost a little bit more. So.
Yeah, I presume if you went for a 22 kilowatt post now, and for some reason you decided in the future you wanted to split it to 3 7-kilowatt posts, it can be done.
Yes, yeah, we can make an actual meter cabinet box and split it all up for yourself. So
yeah, so you can either go 22 today or have 3 lots of 7-kilowatt systems.
Yeah, we can do that.
So Paul's fitting the Zappi here. We've got two cables here, so what's the big chunky one? I presume that's the power cable.
Yeah, so that's the HO7 5-core 6mm cable. 6mm cable's perfectly capable for this run. 5-core because you've got your 3 phases, neutral and earth.
Okay, and the other cable, what's that for?
That's your Cat6 cable, which we're going to use to connect your CT clamps in your distribution board to the Zappi.
Okay, so the Cat6 is not for the internet connection for the Zappi?
No, that does it all through the hub, which we'll explain in a bit.
Okay, so that Cat6 cable is for the CT clamps, but
yep.
Which normally in a home situation would be for solar divert.
Yep.
Now, I presume because it's 3 phase, we're getting 3 CT clamps
yep,
for each phase.
Yep, so we get 3, so yep, round black glowing.
Okay, but why do we need the CT clamps even without solar?
So yeah, you've not got solar. If you've got it in the future, that's going to be great. You've got that like application already in there. But at the moment, you're going to be able to see all your garage usage, so all your lighting, everything like that. You'll be able to see how much you're using. And judging by that data, you'll be able to make cost saving efficiency, like putting LED lights in for your garage example.
Okay, so I'll be able to see not only what the Zap is using, but other stuff and reduce usage and basically, it's like having a smart meter built into a Zappi.
Yeah, exactly. So you can see all your usage on the myenergi app, and it's perfect for that. So,
and if I had solar in the future, can we still monitor those 3 supplies and have solar? So can we have 5 CT clamps or 6 CT clamps?
Yeah, so you could actually just do it from the 3 main grid ones.
Yeah.
And it will do it all for you. But to get added functionality, it is better to have additional CT clamps.
So. And then for that, we'd need a Harvey.
Yes, yeah. Okay. Just a Harvey device, which will wirelessly communicate from the Zappi to the Harvey further down in your distribution board.
The other thing you were saying about the Zappi, obviously I've gone on a lot before, is that it doesn't need an earth rod.
Yeah, exactly. It's one of the main benefits.
And I presume for workplace chargers, for like my site, for example, if it's on a PME system, putting loads of earth rods in a car park, tarmac car park would
be... It's not the best.
It'd be a bit of a nightmare.
Yeah, a massive challenge to get an earth rod in, especially to your car park. It's fully tarmacked. So have we got the drawings for it? No, it's an added expense to get the drawings for the car park. We don't know where the water mains are. We don't know where the electric supply comes in. It's a massive game changer.
Yeah, so for something like a Zappi on a site like mine, tarmac site,
yeah,
it just for, perfect, cost, yeah, for costing insulation, it's
yeah,
not only for the customer, but also for the installer, it makes it a lot easier.
Yeah, yeah, and we can give you a price which is accurate then. So we don't have to put in 20 earth rods, for example. We know there's no earth rods and it's just a simple install. So.
Yeah, so it's not just the benefit for homes who, you know, need to have an earth rod, it's also the benefit for workplace chargers.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Is there any circumstances where you don't need to put earth rods in for other charge points at workplace chargers?
Yes, so you only need an earth rod if you've got a PME supply. If you've got any other different types of supply, you should be fine without an earth rod, depending on the earth reading.
As Paul's now finishing off the electrical wiring and stuff over there,
yep,
you've got another little bit of the Zappi, which is the internet bit. So we've got no Ethernet from the Zappi. It's radio signaled,
yep,
to
the hub device, which is relatively small little device that connects to your power and to your Ethernet, and then it makes a wireless signal which goes over to your Zappi.
And that does everything from firmware updates.
Yeah, firmware updates. You've got the app on your phone, so you can see all of your garage usage, and yeah, makes it smart. So.
And can you see exact usage of what the Zappi's been using?
Yep, so you can see the usage of the Zappi, and you can also change the different modes. So okay. Eco, Eco Plus and Fast.
All remotely?
All from the app, and like make advantage of your boost timers, stuff like that.
And how often does Zappi update the software?
So yeah, they mainly do it for bug fixes, but you also get like firmware updates with like new features as well, so like the pin lock and locking the cable.
Okay, so it's advisable to keep that fairly accessible just in case it needs resetting, for
yeah,
example.
Exactly, so it's just like little update buttons, so normally tuck it behind your router, as long as you can get it easy enough, then it's fine.
Paul's going to connect these up, isn't he?
Yep, they are the CT clamps.
So each of these CT clamp goes on each face?
Yes, yep. Yeah.
And then?
That's going to get connected to the Cat6 cable, which goes over to your Zappi.
Okay, and all these Cat6 cable, the Cat6 cable that goes over to the Zappi three phase actually has three connections in for the
yes, yep.
Zappi.
Yep.
But the single phase one only has two connections for the...
It's got three there, but it only uses two.
Only uses two, but, yep. on the three phase one, all three
are all used. Three are active, yeah, so you can use them all.
And what does how does this work then, George? Because you're the engineer, so...
Yeah, so you've got your primary side, which is your phase cable, goes into there, close it down, then your secondary side is connected to these two, which go over to your Zappi.
And how does that monitor? How does it actually work?
So yeah, your primary side makes a magnetic field picked up by that coil, which sends the low voltage signal over to there.
Okay, so basically it monitors the electrical current by the magnetic
field. Yeah, induced
field.
Induced current through there, yes.
Okay, and that's similar to the way that the Zappi system works for working out if there's been a fault on the earth as well, isn't it?
Yes, yeah, it's got similar CT clamps inside the Zappi unit, which detects
it. It's all built inside.
Yes.
And it's got other stuff built inside as well. Has it got its own inbuilt RCD as well?
Yeah, onto the board, yeah. It's certainly very good. The way
yeah,
they do it.
It's very clever the way they've condensed it all into one box.
Yes, yeah, exactly that.
Paul's finished installing it now, and you've set all this up in the background.
Yep.
Now, I've never had a Zappi before, so I know there's a couple of things I can do with it. We can pin lock it so no one else can use it.
Yep, so if you've, like, during the day, I'm sure you'd want people to use it so you can have customers come in, charge up.
Well, physically I'm not allowed, this is just my workplace
charger.
Yeah,
it's your workplace one.
So, this, I want a password lock so no one else can use it. Sorry, anyone who's watching this video.
Sorry, it's not going to be on ZapMap. So yeah, we'll lock it down, so you'll only know your PIN code. So yeah, it'll be locked to you, so nobody else can come and use it, which is good for in the night. You don't want any randomers to come and like, steal your power. So we can set that up. Other things, when you get your solar, we've got Eco Plus mode and Eco mode.
So that'll monitor my solar output.
Monitor your solar output and divert it straight into your car.
So yeah, perfect, so for businesses like me, businesses now do not, there's no energy company that will offer export for solar for businesses. So if I have a load of solar installed, I need to use it all. So the only way of doing it is with a Zappi.
Yeah, exactly. So you just keep it plugged in all day and it'll just charge up on the excess solar you've got after your building's taken it. So.
Okay, that's great. And then, The obviously charge delays as well, so I can set it to only come on during the day if I didn't want people to charge during the night.
Yep, perfect. There's also a smart boost feature, Where, say, if you're finishing at, say, 4 o'clock, and you want a full battery, you can say, I want 20 kilowatts by 4 o'clock. And what that'll do is use all the solar until it's getting about, say it's like about 3 o'clock and it thinks, actually, I need to use the grid power. It'll actually use the grid power to make sure you've got them 20 kilowatts before 4 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, it's a perfect idea. Say if Friday night, you need to go to the airport after work.
George, one other thing is, obviously this is now capable of three phase. So the cable I've got in my BMW is only single phase. So I'm going to be buying a three phase cable so I can charge that three phase.
Yes, yeah.
If I wanted to wrap the cable around this and leave it locked in, you can lock the cable in this now permanently, can't you?
Yes, yeah, you can do that now, yeah.
And how do you take the cable out? Is it a pin number or can you just pull it?
It's a pin number to take it out.
So once the cable's locked in, it'll pin it in so you can't steal it?
Yeah, exactly. Or you can just have it freely where you can remove it if you want to.
So we got the car plugged in, hub set up, show me how the hub works.
Yep.
Show me that I need to change all my lights to LEDs.
Yes, you definitely do.
pulling quite a lot of power.
Like 3 kilowatts just in,
just in lights, yeah. So they need to be changed.
Yeah, definitely.
Zappi's all plugged in.
Obviously, charging 7 kilowatts. So.
Yeah, because I'm only plugged into a single phase cable, but I'm going to probably steal Laura's three phase cable because she never travels away from home, so I might as well
perfect.
Use it for the BM.
Swap,
And the advantage is now I can now charge at work faster than a granny cable.
Yeah, it's going to save you so much time.
Paul's just took some photos of the Zappi and where my car's parked.
Yes.
What's that for?
That's for the OLEV Grant. So you need to get the charge point serial number and you need to prove that you've got off-street parking, which obviously you have. So yeah,
well, no, it's not off-street parking, it's my work.
Yeah, it's your workplace.
Charging.
Parking, so yes, yeah.
All right, well, thank you very much, George. Thank you very much for filming. Thank you, if you've enjoyed this video, don't forget to subscribe and give it a thumbs up. The only thing left for me is to pay George, so I'm gonna go. See ya.